Now it's time to talk about overfitting in neural networks. If you worked with machine learning before, I'm sure you're familiar with what overfitting is, but let's go over it quickly and then we will talk about specific cases with neural networks and how to solve overfitting with them. So let's say this is a piece of data that we have. The x-axis shows us the input and the y-axis shows out the output. So every time the input is here, let's say this is 5, the output is going to be, let's say this was 10. If we fit this a nice model, this is what it's going to look like because it's very obvious, right? There is a nice little curve here and that's the pattern in the data. So this is what a proper model would look like that fit this data set. But if you fit it in an overfitted way, this is what's going to happen. You're basically not able to generalize anymore. You're looking all of these single examples in your data set and you are following their path, kind of like match the dots or like connect the dots sort of thing. But of course, you know, this looks pretty good. It looks like we will be able to predict everything very well. So what is the problem with this? Well, the problem is, so when you put them side to side, what happens is this is not the real world, right? The data set that you have is just a representation of the real world. It's just a subset of the real world. And it is not complete. It's going to miss some information that is going to be out there or some cases that are out there. What's going to happen is when you introduce these new cases, the real world cases that you do not have in your training data set, your model is not going to predict it very well because it is not able to follow the actual pattern of the data like this one. It's only following the pattern or the data sets, data points in your data set, in the training data set. So for example, for this one, the error was only going to be this much, right? But now because the line is following all these dots, we're going to have a bigger error. So that's why we don't want a model that's overfitted. Overfitting does not, even though it looks good on the training set, it's not going to look good on the validation and test sets. And it's not going to give us a good performance in the real world. There is another side of this coin, of course, which is underfitting. And underfitting is when you are not able to understand the data, when you are not able to fit the data or see any pattern in the data. And this is more or less what it would look like. So a model that is not able to understand what's going on with the data in a way. All right, so how do we understand if our model is overfitting or not? Because, you know, most of the time, we're not only going to have one input feature, we're going to have many input features. We cannot just put them on a plot and see, okay, how is the data or how is the model fitting here? So in that case, what we're going to look at is validation and training losses. You can also look at the performance of validation and training. This could be if you're calculating accuracy or any other thing. Epochs in our case, in neural networks case, is how many times we ran the neural network on the training data. Maybe you remember that from the previous video. As I said, every time we run the whole data on the neural network, every time the network has seen all of the data points, that is one epoch. And we do that multiple times. And every time we do it, your model learns the data a little bit better. It fits it a little bit better. And our loss gets lower and lower and lower. So the lower line here, the green one, is a training loss. So what's going to happen typically is that training loss is going to get lower and lower and lower the more times that you showed the training data to your network. Whereas validation loss, which is the group of data points that you're setting aside and not showing to your network while training, you're only showing it after training, that one is going to go lower and lower too. But at some point, at the point where your model starts overfitting, you're going to see worse performance for validation data, and your validation loss is going to get higher and higher. So when you see something like this, where training loss is going down and validation loss is getting up, going higher after a point, that means that you're starting to overfit. So this is how we understand overfitting happens. So let's look at it in a different way. I don't know if you ever heard of these terms, but these are very important terms in the general AI world, machine learning world. So there we have bias and variance. Bias is basically how far you are from the actual predictions, or if we want to define it, we can say the difference between the mean of the predictions, all of the predictions, compared to the mean of all of the actual values. So how far you are from the actual values, how far your predictions are from the actual values. Variance is how spread out your predictions are. So it's basically how it's not really the center is further away from the actual values, but it's more that your spread is your variation or standard deviation, if you want to think of it that way, is bigger than what the actual values are. So if you look at a nice little chart, let's say this middle bit, this is for the same data set, let's say this middle bit is where all the actual values are. And this is what we're trying to predict. If we have high bias on a network, on a machine learning model, our predictions are going to be all the way over here, even though they have to be all in this little circle. If we have high variance, even though we want them to be all in this little circle, they're going to be all over the place. So, but what does that mean? How does that map to overfitting, underfitting? What's happening? So these are actually really closely related to overfitting and underfitting. If we have high bias, that means that our training performance is going to be low. And that means we're underfitting, as in we're not able to fit the data at all. If you have high variance, that means that our variance performance is going to be very low compared to the training performance. And that means that we are overfitting. So right now, of course, you might say, well, low as opposed to what? What do you mean by training performance is low? That is something we can compare to a reasonable performance. Let's say there is a task where you're supposed to, I'm going to give the same example, where we're supposed to look at images and see which digit is written on that image, like handwritten digit is written on that image. If a model that we know from before, a person or a person performance is, let's say, gives us 0.5 loss, and our model is giving us like 0.1% loss is the reasonable expected one, and our model is giving us 10% loss, then we know we are not able to fit this model. We are not able to fit this data. Same with high variance. Then we can look at, for that one, we can look at the difference between training performance and validation performance. If our training performance is giving us 1% loss and validation performance is giving us 5% loss, obviously there is some disparity in there. But, you know, let's say the training performance is also not super high. It's giving us 5% loss. And validation performance is giving us 6% loss. Even though that sounds like a high number, it will still not be a big difference. So we can't really say we're overfitting. But that's a little side note. So how do we deal with these problems? Let's look at that. So if we have high bias, as in if we are underfitting, what we can do is, that means we're not able to understand the data, right? We're not able to fit the data properly. So we can either train a little bit more. We can use more epochs, try to see if we can fit the data. If that doesn't work, that might mean that our model is not complex enough to understand the data. So you might want to add more layers, you might want to add more neurons, or try a completely different architecture. This could be, you know, trying a CNN or RNN or something that is a bit more advanced. So because obviously what you have built right now is not able to understand the data. On the other side, if we are overfitting, what can we do? So the first thing that we can try, if it's available to you, which might not be, it's not always available, is to introduce more data, introduce more data points. That is, as I said, is not always possible. So then we might need to do some extra steps. So what can that be? Again, we can use a different model architecture, see if that makes any difference. But this is the thing that we're going to learn in this lesson. That thing we can do is regularization. So there are a bunch of regularization techniques that we can apply to combat overfitting in neural networks. If you ever worked on this before, if you ever studied it before, you might have actually heard of bias and variance as a trade-off thing. They're called bias and variance trade-off. But the thing is, actually, they're not really a trade-off anymore when it comes to neural networks. That was kind of like pre-deep learning era information. Actually, with neural networks, we are able to do some things that will lower the bias itself without making the variance higher and vice versa. And how we can do that is, for example, if you just increase the model complexity, you will lower the bias. Yes, you might need to use some regularization. Regularization will help you keep your variance in control, and the complexity of the model will help you lower your bias. On the other hand, you can introduce more data, and that's actually going to only combat overfitting, and that's not going to increase your bias. So these are good things to know. And so now we're going to look more into more detail of how we can do regularization. Regularization can come in a bunch of different ways. So the first way is to constrain a model, or in a way kind of simplifying it. So I don't know if you ever heard of this term, degrees of freedom. It basically means in how many different ways one thing can change. So you can actually use it for like your arm or your hand too. So my hand can move this way, it can move sideways, I can also move it diagonally, I guess. So let's say it has 3 degrees of freedom. If I say I'm not allowed to move it this way from now on, then I can only do it sideways, right? So then I'm basically simplifying the movement of my hand. That's basically more or less the same idea that we have with regularization and this type of regularization. We're trying to make the model a little bit simpler to combat overfitting. Some ways of doing that is L1 and L2 regularization. They're similar approaches, just a little bit different. We'll talk about them in a second. We have dropout regularization, we have early stopping, and we have the other type of regularization where we combat overfitting by adding more information. And that can also be just, you know, adding more data to your system, to your machine learning model or to your neural network. But we will also see how to do data augmentation and how that can help us.